Praise the Lord, everybody. Praise the Lord. It's good to be in the house of the Lord, isn't it? Amen. We'll just encourage you here while Jennifer's coming. She's going to be leading us in some worship tonight and singing. But why don't you just begin to lift up your hands and call upon the Lord. Praise God. If you have needs tonight, praise God. I believe the Lord is the author and the finisher of your faith. In Jesus' name. That's right. Come on, He can do anything. you, Jesus.
Thank you.
and again with the voice of triumph. Shout and again with the voice of praise. Shout and again with the voice of triumph. We lift your name up. We lift your name up. Shout and again with the voice of triumph. Shout and again with the voice of praise. Shout and again with the voice of triumph. We lift your name up. We lift your name up. Shout unto God with the voice of triumph. Shout unto God with the voice of praise. Shout unto God with the voice of triumph. We lift your name up. We lift your name up. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Praise the name of the Lord. Praise God. Praise God. You can be seated. The Lord bless you if you can. Praise God. A little bit of victory going on in the house. Hallelujah. A little bit of victory going on in the house. And why not? Come on, folks. Shouldn't we take full advantage of having Jesus on our side? Come on. Shouldn't we take full advantage of it? Praise God. Let's try it again. Maybe we can sit down. And if you feel like standing up, you can do it anytime. Praise God. I'm telling you, folks, why not take advantage of Jesus being on our side? He is. If God be for us, who can be against us? Come on. And I'll tell you, I thank God. I thank God for that in Jesus' name. Oh, yes. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. 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 Praise the name of the Lord. Hallelujah, Jesus. Praise God. Praise God. You might want to check before you get home. It's probably gone. Yeah. Yeah, I'm talking about whatever it was that was messing with you, whether it be mental, whether it be physical, whether it be spiritual. Praise God. In the presence of the Lord, it gets taken care of, doesn't it? Hallelujah. There you go. Amen. Amen. We had a message that was preached at our variety this year, this summer, and I keep reminding myself every time I walk around this building, the walls are down. Not that I'm praying for them to come down. No, they're already down. And so we realize that, and we realize that we have the advantage through Jesus Christ in Jesus' name. Praise God. I am tonight in charge of letting you know some information tonight. Brother Fitzner is going to come here in just a little bit, and he's going to be preaching the word to you. And so that is his deal, praise God. But here in a few weeks, I just want to let you know, many of you have heard me make reference to the fact of Call to War. It's I'm not going to call it a program. I believe it's a vision that God gave some of our ministers on the East Coast. And for probably the last 5 years, I think 5 or 6 years, they've been conducting a seminar in usually the month of November is when they do this, in Annapolis, Maryland, and you can stream into it. A couple of years ago, this church did that, and we were greatly benefited, greatly benefited from it. This year, they're going to be doing something different, and the felt led of the Lord to approach this in a different light, praise God, and that is to get as much participation as possible. Amen. And so hopefully you will consider that. That's why I'm giving you the opportunity to do that and make your plans in Jesus' name. Praise God. I want you to turn in your Bibles real quickly here to the book of Daniel. The book of Daniel, actually it's chapter number 10, I believe it is. And I want to show you something here. Daniel was, as the Bible says, was a man that was greatly beloved. He had the favor of God in his life, and he was positioned in a place that God was using him over and over and over again. The book of Daniel basically shares that with us in many, many realms. But this is what I want you to see, praise God. The Bible says in verse number 11. Actually, let me begin in verse number 1 here. Chapter 10 of Daniel in verse number 1. And then I'm just going to kind of go down here real quickly here. The Bible says, in the third year of Cyrus, king of Persia, a thing was revealed unto Daniel. See, I'm not the only one that uses the term thing, okay? It says, whose name was Belteshazzar. And the thing was true, but the time appointed was long. It goes on to say, and he understood the thing and had understanding of the vision. Everybody say Daniel. Yeah, okay? Well, the Bible says, and in those days, I, Daniel, was mourning 3 full weeks. He gave himself to fasting and praying for 21 days. Amen. This is where we get sometimes the concept of the Daniel fast. God, Daniel afflicted himself in these kind of unique ways. And the Bible says this is how he fasted. He said, I ate no pleasant or desirable food or bread, neither came flesh nor wine to my mouth, neither did I anoint myself at all till 3 whole weeks were fulfilled. And then what I want to do is I want to fast forward down to verse 11. I'm not trying to take this out of context. I'm just trying to make a point. Everybody say 21 days. He did that. He was involved in prayer and fasting, okay? And then the Bible says, and he said unto me, then after the 21 days, there was an angel of the Lord that came to him. And I had the angels of the Lord are in this place tonight. I mean, there's no question about it. They are ministering spirits. And the Bible says that he said, that angel said, O Daniel, a man greatly beloved, understand the words that I speak unto thee and stand upright, for unto thee am I now sent. And he goes on to say, he says, and when he had spoken this word unto me, I stood trembling. Then said he unto me, fear not, Daniel, for from the first day that thou didst set thine heart to understand and to chasten thyself before thy God, thy words were heard. And I am come for thy word. Now, what has this got to do with us? Well, if you study the revelations that were given to Daniel, it was tremendous. I mean, you and I can map out a lot of the end times because of what God revealed to him. Amen. And I believe that strategically that's what's happening in our world today. Praise God. Apostolic churches all along the way, praise God, are put in some strategic places where God will do this. Well, what call to war has taken on the identity of doing this year is from the 4th of October. Now, you can put this in your calendar if you want. I think you should. From the 4th of October till the 24th of October. This is what all over the world people are going to do. They're going to enter into a realm of prayer and fasting, afflicting themselves. And I probably here in maybe even Wednesday night, I might insert it in part of what we're teaching, that type of thing. I'm going to teach again the concepts of fasting. And really what the goal here is to get as many people involved during this 21 days as possibly can. And then at the end of that 21-day period, on the 24th of October, and this church is already signed up for it. We're already part of what's going to be going on. We want to do all that we can here. And so the evening of the 24th, what they have done is they've scheduled all over the world. They've scheduled churches, individuals, people that are going to be praying constantly from the 24th through the 29th. And not just any ordinary prayer, but a prayer of warfare. And man, I'm going to tell you something. There are strongholds that are going to come down all over this world. I'm absolutely believing it in Jesus' name. And what I'm here tonight to do, and I don't want to belabor this because I want Brother Fitzner to come and to preach, but I just want to acquaint you with the fact that we're, as a church, and as many of you that can, praise God, we want you to make your plans to join. Now, I'm not telling you how much to do. Let me just make a suggestion. Would that be okay? Okay? I think that there's not anybody in this place that couldn't give up one meal a day for 21 days. Now, if God presses you to do more, you're not going to get any argument from me. But I think that every person in this place could come together in the aspect that we're going to give up one meal a day for 21 days. God might move on you for a different way. You know, the Daniel fast can involve different areas of our life. But that's just one suggestion, because I don't think that anybody is to the point where they couldn't get involved in that. And really what this is, this 21 days, is a time of preparation. Because when a church, an individual, and peoples, when they enter into warfare prayer, folks, I'm going to tell you something. Literally, all hell is going to be broken loose. And there are things that are going to try to come against. And I'm not trying to scare anybody. I'm just trying to prepare you. And that's why Daniel, you see the situation there, that for 21 days he was in spiritual warfare. And the Bible says that angel came and he said, listen, he said, from the first day I heard your prayers, but there was something hindering us. And of course, we know at that time it was the prince of Persia. And I don't know what kind of princes are out there right now that want to oppose this. But folks, I believe in our world that you and I are living in, we're running out of time. We just are. And I know we've heard that for years, and that can become a cliche. Jesus is coming back. Yeah, I've heard that ever since I got into the church almost 40 years ago. But the bottom line is, folks, there's no question about it. There are some turbulent things that are happening amongst us right now. And what it is I believe it's a time that God wants the church, the apostolics, people that believe in the name of Jesus, people that know that being filled with the Holy Ghost is the will of God, people that understand the doctrine. I believe it's time for those people to come together and begin to be unified in Jesus' name. And so this is what I wanted to introduce to you tonight. I'm not going to go into this in detail tonight as the days and the next couple of weeks come upon us. I am going to be mentioning more and more of this, but I just wanted to lay those dates on your heart. The 4th of October through the 24th, you know, there's going to be 21 days of preparation, praise God. And then on the 24th, that's when combined prayer is going to come forth, praise God. A couple of years ago when a few of us got together and we were involved in what they were doing back in Annapolis, that changed the way some people were thinking, literally. I've noticed that about their lives. It was a life changer. Not just a time that was, oh yeah, I remember that. No, this was something that literally changed the way they looked at things. And I'm expecting the same thing to happen to us in Jesus' name. Would you just lift up your hands right now and let's ask the Lord to help us to consider being a part of this. Would you do that? Would you just ask the Lord to help you to do that? Oh, Lord Jesus, I believe this is of you, Lord. I have confidence and faith in what's happening here, Lord God, this combined effort to come against the spirits of darkness. I believe that is your will, Lord God. And right now, I just ask you, Lord Jesus, to put it upon every heart right now, young and old alike. I believe everyone in here could get involved in this, Lord Jesus. And Lord God, I believe it would change not only the direction of the individual, but it would begin to change the direction of this entire church in Jesus' name. Lord, have your way here. As our brother comes and preaches the word tonight, Lord God, let him have his liberty. Let us be attentive to what the word says. And Lord God, I give you the praise and I give you the glory in Jesus' name. Amen. Praise God. Praise God.
Hallelujah, Jesus. Thank you, God. Hallelujah, Jesus. We praise your mighty name, God. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. What an awesome, mighty, powerful God we serve, and he He is already doing some great things in this service tonight. So if we get to a point where the preaching just can't go any further, or preaching or teaching, whatever you'd like to call it, then let's just let God move in a mighty way in this place here tonight. You know, it's so exciting to see just that fervent, passionate worship of Jesus Christ. It's, you know, Ephesians, going back to Ephesians chapter 6, talking about the spiritual warfare and these things that we get into, and I just feel I need to tap on this just real quick, talking about how we need to put on some things before we go into battle and before we take hold of some things. It talks about a breastplate of righteousness, the sword of the Spirit, shield of faith, helmet of salvation, feet shod with the gospel, the preparation of peace, the loins girt about with truth. These are things that we must put on and go into battle with, and for the most part, those are defensive pieces of armor. They're pieces of armor that are meant to protect you, and God has put those in place for a reason. There's a specific place there. But for a lot of us, for those of us who were new to this thing, and those of you who are new to this thing, when you're handed that sword, it's a pretty amazing thing. It's a shiny thing. It's sharp. It's pointed. You can go out and you can destroy things with it. You can do some crazy things with this sword. But it can be dangerous as well if you misuse it and don't use it the right way. And sometimes we get that sword and we begin to just swing it around violently, and it's not cutting the places that it needs to cut, or specifically touching the things that it needs to touch. And ultimately, we use that sword in a dangerous way without humility and without direction from God. And it can cause us some issues later on down the road. But this 21 days will ultimately change that. This conference, when Pastor spoke of it a couple years ago when I was here, it changed my life being inside of that conference and really just directing that sword towards the enemy instead of just swinging it around violently and cutting myself and hurting myself and harming myself with my own sword. So you have to begin to focus those things in. And in this 21 days of prayer and fasting will ultimately do that. It will begin to narrow that down to a specific place. But not only that, this conference is something that you want to attend, because it will direct you directly where you need to go and where you need to use those weapons. So praise God. It's an exciting thing. So you want to be a part of that, and you want to enjoy that as well, because it's going to be absolutely great in Jesus' name. So tonight, I did not expect to have this much time, but praise God, we'll see where he goes, and we'll go forward. Praise God. Yes, amen. I love to hear our pastor preach. Amen. And he is a great leadership role model. If we can turn to 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, this is where we're going to kind of go through. I'm just going to kind of let God lead and go where he needs to go and see what he would like to do. In 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, just beginning at verse number 1. I'm going to pretty much read this entire chapter, but just letting God do some great things here. But of the times and of the seasons, brethren, you have no need that I write unto you, for you yourselves know perfectly that the day of the Lord so cometh as a thief in the night. Nobody knows when Jesus is going to come back, but it's going to be at some point in time when he comes back and takes us with him. Praise God. For when they shall say peace and safety, then sudden destruction cometh upon them as travail upon a woman with child, and they shall not escape. But you, brethren, are not in darkness. Praise God. That day should overtake you as a thief. It's saying that you're not in darkness, you're not a thief, and that day's not going to overtake you, because you will be prepared for it if you're serving God. And verse 5 says, you are the children of light and the children of the day. We are not of the night nor of that darkness. Therefore, let us not sleep as others do, but let us watch and be sober. For they that sleep, sleep in the night, and they that be drunken are drunken in the night. But let us who are of the day be sober, putting on the breastplate of faith and love, and for a helmet, the hope of salvation. Praise God. Those are some powerful words right there. That is something to rejoice about and get excited about, that I am not of that darkness, or I'm not of the worldly things that come around us, but I am ultimately of the light that shines and that takes care of that darkness every place that I walk, wherever I go. That's part of that spiritual warfare, walking through this life and seeing things changed and transformed all around us. Even when we don't know it, God is working in a mighty, powerful way. It would be so awesome. I told the youth group this morning, if we could strip away the physical physical realm in this place here tonight and see what God is doing and see the battle that is around us and see that our light is making a difference inside of that because of the Jesus Christ that's flowing through us. And my goodness, we would be jumping and shouting and running aisles more often than just once in a while or once a month. But praise God, we are children of the light ultimately and not children of darkness. Hallelujah. Praise God. Can we just praise Him for that light? Thank you, Jesus. Praise God. If you want to be seated, you can. I'm going to kind of just go through this chapter here and let God lead. I don't know about some of you, but my prayer this last week has hit a new level or a different place that it seems like God is talking about warfare going on around us in so many different places, in so many different ways. I didn't know that this 21 days of prayer and fasting was coming up until just recently, but this week, God was putting things inside of my house and putting things inside of my mind with visions and different stuff that I was seeing about this spiritual warfare that is going on around us. And the cool part is that we are winners inside of that, just standing there rising above and letting God shine this light through us so that we can see great things happening. Verse 8 says, but let us who are of the day be sober, putting on the breastplate of faith and love. That's the awesome thing about our battle is that we're not going out there to destroy people. We're not going out there because we hate people, or we're not going out there because we're better than people. But we are going out there because we have faith in God and we have a love for those people that are around us and we want to see their souls saved just as much as we want to see our own souls saved in Jesus' name. We have a love for those people. We must have a desire to see them come to God. Ultimately, that's what our warfare is about. And if the warfare is about bringing down somebody else as far as a human being, then that's not godly warfare. Our warfare is about taking the flesh down, bringing that down, bringing Satan down, bringing that darkness down, and being a light into this world so that those around us, we can lift them up and we can bring them to the Jesus Christ that we serve. And so verse 9 goes on to say, for God hath not appointed us unto wrath or unto anger, but to obtain salvation by our Lord Jesus Christ. We were meant to be living with Jesus Christ. We were meant to have salvation in Him being baptized in that water and receiving the gift of the Holy Ghost. It says in verse 10 that Jesus died for us, that whether we were awake or asleep, we should live together with Him. Praise God. Isn't it awesome that even though we were asleep, God still died for us? Even though we were not serving Him at that moment in time, God still died for us. Even though there were times in our lives that we walked away from Him, He still died for us so that we could come together with Him and live with Him in Jesus' name. Praise God. Verse 11, wherefore, comfort yourselves together and edify one another, even as also ye do. Basically saying, don't put down your brother. Don't put down those things that are around you. Lift up each other. And as you go into this battle, encourage one another because you have, your words are powerful and you can see things change and you can see things done. And if you encourage somebody, you never know what that's going to allow them to do or cause them to do in the kingdom of God. And we beseech you, brethren, to know them which labor among you and are over you in the Lord and admonish you, and to esteem them very highly in love for their work's sake, and be at peace among yourselves. Now we exhort you, brethren, warn them that are unruly, comfort the feeble-minded, support the weak, be patient toward all men. That's something that we all can definitely work on. See that none render evil for evil unto any man, but ever follow that which is good, both among yourselves and to all men. Render that which is good. We don't render evil. We render that which is good because we are the light of Jesus Christ. And these next seven things are the things that I really want to focus on here tonight because I think ultimately they will help you with praying and fasting, and I think they will be something that will encourage you in Jesus' name. It says in verse 16, just two words, to rejoice evermore. Praise God. We're letting some of that loose here tonight in Jesus' name with our rejoicing and with our praising unto God. That's an exciting thing. But you know, the cool thing about rejoicing evermore is that even when we don't feel like it, we can come into a place like this and we can still jump and we can still shout and we can still sing praises unto our God, because we know how worthy He is and how mighty He is, and we know that His Spirit is still here, and His Spirit is not going to leave us no matter how down or depressed or how guilty or shameful we feel. But ultimately, that presence and that Spirit is going to be here no matter what. We can rejoice. We can still be excited even when we don't feel what God has wanted us to feel at that moment. We have the joy of the Holy Ghost in Jesus' name. Praise God. That's why I love that song, that we have the joy of the Holy Ghost, and it's falling all over me, and I want to praise and shout and sing praises unto Jesus because of who He is. I want to rejoice evermore, even in those times of fasting, even when my flesh does not feel good because I'm fasting. I can rejoice evermore because ultimately that battle that's going on around me, we are winning. We are triumphant in Jesus' name because of who He is. Hallelujah, in Jesus' name. So as you enter into that fasting, as you enter into those things there, don't let them bring you down, but ultimately let it encourage you that in Jesus' name the battle is strong, and even though we're fewer in number, we will win and we will come out on the other side. It is so cool and so awesome. Praise God. You see, in Matthew chapter 25, there's this story of these talents and these men who are given these talents by Jesus to go out and do something with these talents. There's some men that go out and increase their talents, but there's also some men that take their talents and bury them in the ground. These men that bury them in the ground, Jesus talks to them and says, What did you do? What's the purpose of that? I'm going to take your talent and give it to somebody else because you didn't do anything with what I have given to you. But Jesus, those that He gave some to, and they went out and did something great with it, He gave even more to, because He knew that they were going to be able to do great things with those things that He had given to them. That's part about being faithful, that in Jesus' name, you know, today God may only give me just a little piece, but in Jesus' name, if I grab a hold of just that little piece and I begin to use it and I begin to work with it on a daily basis and begin to let it grow into something else, God will begin to give me more and more to begin to see things change and transform around me. That's why even if you just have a little hope as far as you woke up this morning and you began breathing, you can rejoice evermore because it's that little thing that you can begin to shout and praise about. And when you begin to shout and praise about that, God's going to add something else in there. He's going to begin to take care of some other matters that you may never thought that He was going to take about. If you're just faithful with coming to service when you're down and out, then God will come in and He will take care of those great big matters that we're putting you inside of that place. I want that joy of the Lord so that I can rejoice evermore every morning when I wake up. And I don't want to be drugged down into the pits of my emotions in so many different ways. I did that for far too long, and I let my emotions control how much I worshiped, how much I praised God, how much I read my word. But I put that on the back burner and said, no more emotions. I'm shutting this flesh down because I'm going to praise God today. I'm going to lift Him up today and shout for praise in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Because He is a great God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise Your mighty name, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah. Yes, Jesus. Praise Your mighty name, God. Hallelujah, Jesus. It's so exciting to be living here in America. We went out with the missionaries Wednesday night, and praise God, He was telling us stories about the things that they face in these other countries as far as opposition when they go to worship and different things. And in Russia, about how they enacted this new law that if you don't have church property, you no longer can be considered a church, and you will be illegal if you meet inside of your house to read the Bible or to have people come together in a fellowship there. Unless you own church property, you are illegal in those places. But praise God, we can come to this place where we have freedom in America still to praise God. And that should just absolutely allow us to rejoice evermore on a daily basis because we're not facing some of those things that those people are. Praise God. But we must pray for them as well in Jesus' name. So when things are going right or when they're going wrong, just keep teaching those Bible studies. Keep going to those people. Keep seeing those things. Keep allowing God to work through your life because He will do some great things. So in this fasting, when those battles come, when the enemy begins to look bigger than you, when those things begin to challenge you, when that opposition is there and it's like, I don't know how I can fast another meal for another day. Well, praise God. You know what? We can rejoice evermore because we were counted worthy to do those things in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Verse 17 gives us some more words, and it says, pray without ceasing. Hallelujah. Uninterruptedly, or praying without ceasing. It's not saying that you're going to be sitting in the church 24/7 praying, but what you will be doing is you're walking around believing in Jesus. You're sensitive to his spirit and who he is. Matthew 6 and verses 5 through 7 talk about finding a prayer closet. And not being as the Pharisees were, just praying out loud, trying to make themselves look so much greater than everybody else, and going into their workplaces and be like, hey, man, I prayed 24 hours last night, so, you know, I'm doing pretty good with this God thing, and it's looking pretty legit. But what it talks about is finding a prayer closet, being sensitive to God, and letting him move through you no matter where you are at. You know, sometimes we pray, God, use me. But when we walk into that grocery store, if God asks you to talk to that person, will you do it? Are you sensitive? Are you going to allow God to move you to the place where you can speak to those around you? We have to be careful what we pray because sometimes it's not exactly where God wants to lead us. Or sometimes it's not even the truth inside of our own heart. But praise God, when we fast, it will begin to take that and narrow that to the place that it needs to be at in Jesus' name. We can sometimes trail towards that idea of the Pharisees, but we can avoid it as well. We must keep our motives correct, believing in Jesus Christ, and we are to overcome things through prayer in Jesus' name. Things like unforgiveness, things like disbelief, things like contention, all these can be overcome in Jesus' name in prayer. I've gotten to the place in life where, man, if I have an ought against my brother, I'm going to forgive him as fast as I possibly can because I don't want to walk into a grocery store. I don't want to walk into a place and have that be the reason that I didn't speak to somebody whose soul could have been saved because I just didn't want to forgive my brother or something like that. Praise God. These are simple things, and I realize that they're big things for somebody who is new coming into some of these things, that praise God, we must get over some of these ideas and allow God to truly just not manipulate, but truly lead us to where we can reach out to those around us. When we come to service, we must get rid of these things. We must get to the prayer room in Jesus' name and see those things set to the side so that we can freely move in here. What if inside of this service, that's the exact thing that holds me back from praying for my brother or something else? But God, I want to be free in you. I want to be free in who you are, and I want to allow you to lead me in the spirit because I want to see things happen in Jesus' name for who he is. I want to be able to pray without fear and pray in faith in Jesus' name to see things changed and challenged in this world. Praise God. Again, it's not because I'm better than anybody else. It's not because we're better than them. It's not that type of a battlefield. But it's because I love my God, and I want to see other people experience that God and who he is. And I don't want Satan to be able to get in the way of that anymore. I don't want to see him take over those people's lives in Jesus' name. Verse 18 goes on to say, in everything give thanks, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus concerning you. Kind of going back to that rejoice evermore again. But in everything, give thanks. For this is the will of God in Christ Jesus concerning you. Saying specifically, it's the will of God for your life. Give thanks. Praise God. Give thanks that you're counted worthy to fast that day. Give thanks that you're worthy to come to church in the mighty presence of the God that we're here with. Give thanks for the God and who he is and what he has done and where he has brought you out of. But give thanks just because he is God and he has that ability. Philippians 4:6 says this, be careful for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be known unto God. Praise God. Be careful for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be known unto God. Psalms 115 says, know ye that the Lord, he is God. It is he that hath made us, and not we ourselves. Praise God. If you made yourself, come and talk to me after service, but It's our God that made us. It is He that hath made us and not we ourselves. We are His people and the sheep of His pasture. Enter into His gates with thanksgiving and into His courts with praise. Be thankful unto Him and bless His name. For the Lord is good, His mercy is everlasting, and His truth endureth to all, every single generation after this scripture. We can stand and give thanks to Jesus because of that, that His truth endures to all generation. That is a powerful, powerful scripture there, because it's not just saying that it was the most powerful back in this time. It's not saying it's the most powerful yesterday, but ultimately to all generations, we now have access to this truth that is here, and it's only going to keep getting better, because there's many, many, many prophecies inside of this Bible that still have not been fulfilled in today's world, and we are the generation, we are the time that is going to get to see a lot of these things unfold in Jesus' name. That is amazing. That is powerful. That is awesome. That is exciting. We can't walk away from God and who He is, because we have to see these things come to pass. Praise God. You want to be a part of this in Jesus' name. It goes on to say in verse 19 of 1 Thessalonians, and don't quench not the Spirit. It says, quench not the Spirit. Praise God. That's a tough one for us as human beings being inside of this flesh. We come to a service like this, and it's awesome, it's powerful. But man, God, I got a little tired from this afternoon or something, you know? Man, playing those drums, that wore me out, God. Like, I'm done. I can't go any further. But you know what? I don't want to let that quench the Spirit of God. If God wants to go all night until midnight, I don't want to stop Him before that midnight time hits. If God wants to heal somebody, if God wants me to pray for somebody for 30 minutes, just all out praying for them and to see something done, I want to be able to do that in Jesus' name. I don't want to quench His Spirit, but I also want to go home. And when God begins to move on me, do you want to do this, or do you want to get into my word? Do you want to do something else, or do you want to get into my word and pray with me? I don't want to shut down what God is doing. And I'm not saying that you can't do other things, but I'm saying that when God moves on you to get into His word, or when God moves on you to pray inside of your households or for your family or whoever it may be, then do it. Don't quench that Spirit that is inside of you, because it's speaking to you for a specific reason. It's directing you for a specific reason, because God knows so many things that we do not know and we do not understand. And so if we don't quench that Spirit, then God will begin to flow through us like rivers of living water, as the Bible says. That Holy Ghost is that comforter in Jesus' name. We must yield or quench not that Spirit. As it says in Romans 6, 12 through 14, I realize I'm giving you a lot of scripture, but you can go and research these and study these out later. But it basically says that sin shall not have dominion over you. For you are not under the law, but you are under grace. Praise God. That's saying you're not under the Old Testament law, where these things were rolled ahead and sin really kind of had this bearing where the people had to continue to push it ahead and over again. And Jesus came down and wiped that sin completely clear, putting us into this dimension that we're in now, where we have grace of God and we can repent and we can give those things to Jesus Christ and we can be baptized and let those things go to ultimately free ourselves from that sin and quench not that Spirit that is inside of us. Hallelujah. We must listen to that Spirit, and we have to shut off the voices of this world and the voices of sin and even our own conceived ideas about how God wants to do something. We're so guilty of that. We spoke of that in the discipleship class tonight. Praise God, you just kind of confirmed everything that was going to come forward tonight. But my goodness, just, you know, we get so many ideas about it, and I'm so guilty of this. Like, God, I want to plan this out. Like, how is this going to work? This at this minute, this person's going to get the Holy Ghost, and at this minute, they're going to get the healing, and it's going to be this way by laying my hands on them this way and by saying these words, and we try to plan these things out. But God just says, you know what? Just don't quench my Spirit. Just listen to me. Just let me flow through you, and it will work. It will come to pass. Just let it work. Don't quench the Spirit, because I want God to be able to move anywhere in anything inside of my life. I want to feel the Spirit. I want to begin to ignite it up so big that my neighbors begin to see it. You know, that's one of my prayers, is that as I'm driving around in my car all day long on my job, that there's a flame there that people will begin to see inside of that place or inside of your house. I pray that for every one of you, that inside of your houses, that they are that light that this scripture talks about at the beginning, that there's a flame above it that attracts people to you because they know who you are and they know the truth that you have. Even standing in that workplace, I know it's tough, but there's people there listening. There's people there watching who you may have never even met before, but they know who you are, and they know what you believe, and they know what you stand for because of who you are in Jesus' name. So don't quench that Spirit when it begins to move on you in those places. Praise God, because God's going to do some great things through you. Continuing on down in verse 20, it says, despise not prophesying. Praise God. I just spoke of this just a couple minutes ago about how there's still many things that need to come to pass inside of our world. There's still many scriptures that need to come to pass in today's world. There's many prophecies that have went forward. And people can stand back and say that those things are foolish or that they were meant for an old time, but they are meant for today still. We need prophets in the land who will go and proclaim God's word and who will proclaim revival and who will proclaim things happening throughout the land in Jesus' name. There's still prophecies of the Jews return. Like, if we think about it, there were old prophecies of the Jews returning to their land, and there's prophecies now of earthquakes in the end times and so many different things. And I realize we don't understand all these or can't comprehend all of these things, but ultimately, if we are sensitive and if we read our scripture and we know what these prophecies say, when they happen, God will confirm them, and we will be able to understand them and know, God, you know what? This is exactly what you spoke about inside of this Bible. There will be no question, but ultimately, Jesus is going to return. And if that's a prophecy that you don't want to believe in, then sorry, but I probably don't want to hang around you that much longer, because in Jesus' name, I know that he is going to return, and I know he's going to come back to this world, and I know that there's going to be one day that I get to live with him in eternity because of who he is. Praise God. That's a prophecy that I don't want to miss. Hallelujah. That's a prophecy that I don't want to let down. Hallelujah, Jesus. And it takes part in acting on it now. Do you believe in the prophecy or do you not? But I don't want to despise these things and risk missing what God has to give to us in Jesus' name. Praise God. Verse 21 says, to prove all things and hold fast that which is good. Prove them. Put them up against the scripture. Put them up against the doctrine that you know is real. When we preach here, prove it. Put it up against the scripture. Put it up against what God has given to you. When you go to the Bible study, whatever's taught there, prove it. Put it up against the scripture and the God that you know. Because if it's real, it will line up. And if it's not, it will take a different area. And if it's not real, then you need to remove that immediately or begin to change something that is inside of there. Because it's not worth hanging around that thing and risking not seeing that prophecy of Jesus coming back. It's not worth it. It's not worth that risk. But we must prove those things. And then when you find those things which are good, we must hold fast to them. When you begin to know that cure for overcoming depression, when you begin to know that cure for overcoming that adversity, when you begin to know that cure for overcoming whatever may be in your future, those things that are going on in your life, don't let go of it. Don't accept it today and then let go of it tomorrow and then pick it back up again. But hold fast to it. That means cling to it. Grab on to it. And whatever you receive tonight, don't let it go when you walk out of the church building, but hold fast to it. Because if you hold fast to it, then it's going to be there tomorrow morning. And you can pick it up and you can get out of your bed and you can walk with it again. And then it brings you right back to where you can begin to rejoice evermore. Because praise God, that joy that I had last night, I bring it with me into the morning. And I begin to praise God throughout the day. And then when I go to bed, I put it next to me again. And I hold fast to it. And I get up the next morning and I begin to praise God again because I have those things that I held fast to. Hold fast to that which is good. Because praise God, it will change your life. Those things that God has given to you in just the smallest forms to transform your life. Those things that God has required of you in the smallest forms. Whenever you find the thing that is good, begin to let it grow. Because praise God, it will do some great things and change you in so many ways. 2 Timothy 2:15 again brought out in the Bible study tonight, speaking about studying to show yourself approved unto God. Again, not that you study to become some favorite of God, but you study because it goes right along with this scripture, that you can prove things, that when those battles come up against you, you know the decision to make because you have already found it inside of the scripture. You know where your stance is at, and you're not going to let Satan overcome you, because Jesus ultimately overcame Satan by the word that was in this Bible, by overcoming it with the truth that was spoken there. That's how Jesus was able to overcome Satan. And if Jesus used that, we as apostolics must follow that same way, that when those battles, when those things come up against us, and when we prove those things, we will prove it up against Scripture, and it will fail, it will fall when it does not line out with what is truth. People don't realize that this is not just another storybook, and I know I've said this so many times, but it's a living word that when you speak it, it will do some powerful things. When you're driving to work, praying inside of your car, it will do some powerful things when you get to that job site. You never know. When you begin to pray around your workplace, pray without ceasing. When you begin to pray inside of those things, and I'm not saying you're super exaggerating or super great about just, you know, exploding these things and letting everybody know that you're praying, but praise God, you're in there speaking the truth and speaking the words of God. It will change the atmosphere around you. And if we could strip away the walls inside of our workplaces again, if we could strip away the walls inside of our houses and see what it does when we speak this gospel and this truth, then we would realize that this scripture is powerful. It's that sword of that spirit that will cut, that will divide, that will do some things and change lives all around us. Praise God. That's powerful. So if something tries to take that from you, don't entertain it. If something doesn't line up with Scripture, don't entertain it. Sidestep it. Juke it or whatever. I think that was a young term in football. Just juke it. Get around it. Whatever you got to do, get around those things and continue walking for God. Find that race. Get in that battle. Do those things that God has asked you to do. If we are apostolic, we need to be bold enough to walk away from situations that are putting us into trouble. If your friends are laughing at it, things like that, it can be tough to walk away from those things. But do it in Jesus' name. When we find that something is good, we must fight to hold on to it. Never let what you have from this church go. Don't place it on the back burner, but testify about the good that is inside of it. Testify about the good that you have found inside of it. Testify about the discipleship class and what God has done inside of you through it. Praise God. And number 7, last but not least, it talks about abstain from all appearance of evil. Basically, to hold oneself off, abstain, to hold oneself off from all appearance, external or outward forms of evil, which is bad or bad nature or condition. Walk away from those things. There are times that we cannot avoid evil inside of this world. For example, if you're driving down the city street in most cities, you will see billboards with stupid stuff on them. I mean, it's ridiculous stuff in so many different ways, and you see these things. There's no way to avoid it because you have to drive by them to get to church and to these places that you're at. But if you're sensitive to God, it'll be so easy to just look at that and bounce your eyes from it. It'll be so easy to begin to speak those words of this Bible, to begin to pray unto God. God, I know that you have the ability to remove those things. God, I know that you have the spirit and the ability to take over the city, God, to remove all those darknesses and all those evils, God. And because you have those things, Jesus, I proclaim that in the liberty in Jesus' name over the city. You can pray that in Jesus' name. You can pray powerful things in Jesus' name. By abstaining from all these things here. Because like I said, those people out there watching, those people out there at the Maverick next door, when we walk over there and buy coffee, there's people watching. There's people who want to see who you are about and what you are about. And we can't have anything that looks somewhat like the devil, because if we do, my goodness, it's going to confuse people. We can't have anything that looks a lot like the flesh, but we need to just remove ourselves from those things and just dive into what God has given to us in Jesus' name. Praise God. Hallelujah. If we can stand across this place, and I'm going to turn it back over to Pastor Carnahan. I wanted to give you those 7 things, and I'll just finish the scripture here real quick because I don't want to leave an unfinished thought. It says, the very God of peace sanctify you wholly. And I pray, God, your whole spirit and soul and body be preserved blameless unto the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, saying, make it to the end. Faithful, faithful is he that calleth you, who also will do it. He's not going to let you down if you take these steps. He's not going to let you dig your own hole and fall into it, but he's going to help you through those situations. He says, brethren, pray for us. Greet all the brethren with a holy kiss, and I charge you by the Lord that this epistle be read unto all the holy brethren. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you. Amen. Praise God. These are seven steps, seven things that you can take in your life and begin to work on a daily basis. We all can improve on these things here more and more. So in Jesus' name, as we enter into this time, as we get closer to this prayer and fasting, if you want to come down to this altar and just really kind of focus on Jesus and get rid of maybe some things that will hinder us inside of that place, and I encourage you to do that and just let God move inside of this place. Let's not cut it short, but let's pray without ceasing here. Let's just not quench this spirit, but let's let God move here in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Let's all just begin to pray and lift up our hands in Jesus' name.
To be a sanctuary, pure and holy, tried and true, it's with thanksgiving, I'll be a living. God, Lord, is breaking every yoke. Hallelujah. Right now, because here I am. Oh, I give all myself to you, Lord. Here I am. Oh, yes, now here I am. Give the Lord a shout of praise in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. In the name of Jesus. Praise God. Praise God. Look at somebody and say opportunities. There's just all kinds of opportunities in this church. Thank you, Brother Fitzner, for that very, very, very good word of the Lord. This week, opportunities. Tuesday night, if you're free, you can come here at 7 o'clock, and there's a prayer group that meets here every Tuesday night at 7 o'clock. That's here at the church. Wednesday night, of course, we'll have Bible study, praise God. And how many love the Word of God? Amen. Let's continue to do that. Praise God. Amen. Saturday, this coming Saturday, and is this going to be done at the Camplex Park? There's going to be a potluck and a snipe hunt. If you've never been on a snipe hunt, you're going to want to go. And so that's at 7 o'clock on Saturday at the Camplex Park. It's the Plark. Yeah, that's what it is. Okay, next week. Everybody say next week.
Next week.
Okay, Tuesday, beginning Tuesday evening, we will be live streaming the general conference that's in Indianapolis. It'll be here at the church. Now, one thing to keep in mind is that they are an hour ahead of us. And so we will beginning those services at 6 o'clock. I know usually on Wednesday night we start at 7 o'clock, but no, we will be here every night at 6 o'clock beginning those services. So you're going to want to be a part of that. That's going to be awesome. So that's Tuesday through Friday. Our general conference will be live streamed here at the church in Jesus' name. So look at somebody and say, opportunity.
Opportunity.
Look at somebody else. Look at somebody else and say, take the opportunity. There you go. God bless you tonight. The Lord bless you tonight in Jesus' name. Amen.